What's going on, everyone? My name is Nicholas Merton here from Data Dash, and today is March 1st of 2024. Well, folks, I hope you are having a fantastic day wherever you are, because in today's video, I want to spend some time to break down the three-day consecutive rally we had here, setting a new relative highs at the end of February, around $64,000. But I want to also try to answer a big question for a lot of people. I have people from both sides of the trade, people who have been long Bitcoin wondering if they should sell, and also people as well who are in cash looking to get in and wondering if it's too late to get into the trend. I'm going to give you guys a genuine take here, try to meet in the middle, and most importantly, focus in on what the data science models as well as the changing market dynamics are telling us about market price for Bitcoin. We got a lot to unpack here in today's video, so if you happen to enjoy it, consider dropping a like. Let's go ahead and kick things off. So I want to dive straight into the charts here, guys. After this three-day run-up here, I want you guys to be made aware that this is very typical price acceleration activity for Bitcoin. We've seen in the past here that there are these multi-green day patterns here where price starts to accelerate. It's usually when there's going to be an excess amount of demand for Bitcoin beyond what OTC markets can satisfy and other means of acquiring Bitcoin through mining channels, etc. And again, we see this generally as there's more and more price discovery for Bitcoin as the accelerated rallies continue to play out here throughout 2023 and 2024, especially post the launch of the ETF. Now, I want to go ahead and talk again a little bit about this dynamic of OTC markets. Now, we've spoken about OTC markets for years here on this channel, as they are an important dynamic to understand around crypto markets. But essentially speaking, OTC markets remove a lot of the excess volatility that may inevitably hit the spot order book, both into the upside and the downside. Essentially, OTC or over-the-counter trading essentially allows for a broker in the middle to match large buyers and large sellers to basically sell and buy at an agreed-upon price. And this helps to mitigate a lot of the excess slippage on the order book that those traders might incur or essentially affect on other traders. Well, one of the big developments that came up is that some of the available data science models out there, mainly cited by Caitlin Long, who I think is one of the really good individuals in this space who I followed for a long time, has stated essentially that the other day the OTC market got so dry, there was only about 40 BTC left. So essentially, what this could mean here is that at current price levels, as we talked about actually in a prior episode just a few days ago on the channel, essentially with the ETF, it's important to understand here that as price moves higher, those OTC volumes for potential sellers will probably increase. And then from there, you're going to have a question of whether or not is there the ETF demand to continue buying up those Bitcoin at that set price, right? So it's not just a guarantee here that these ETF inflows are just going to accelerate price forever, because eventually, as you move higher, you do get more BTC coming in. It seems, however, though, very clearly within price here, that there was the demand for it. We had a couple of 10K BTC inflow days for the ETF shares out there, whether you're talking about the BlackRock iShares, Bitcoin ETF, if you're talking about Fidelity, some of the major ones out there that have swallowed up a lot of that Bitcoin, and even taking into account a lot of that negative sell side pressure from the Genesis bankruptcy liquidation of around 25,000 Bitcoin. We don't know if all those Bitcoins have been sold, but it's pretty clear right by now, though, as there was about 10,000 Bitcoin outflows, or I think 9.2K the other day, a lot of that has probably been offloaded. And is clearly getting swallowed up here by existing demand in the market. So at current price levels, it is clear here that the OTC desk has gotten dry, there's not enough powder there, and essentially those who are running those ETF products are essentially having to buy directly from spot now. And this can lead towards some really interesting price dynamics here. So long as we don't see those OTC numbers starting to tick back up, where it can take some of that buy side pressure away from the order book, price can continue to accelerate to some degree. However, I want to go ahead and say that, as I mentioned, as price moves higher here, don't be shocked if that OTC number starts to reverse and some large people start looking to satisfy those ETF demands, which is going to remove some of the beneficial factor on the order book for accelerating Bitcoin's price. It's not to say that it's going to crush demand for the ETF. What I'm saying here is that you have to worry about those dynamics, both sides. You have to hope that the ETF flows are going to keep going. And along with that as well, you got to hope that there's not going to be a lot of whales who have been holding Bitcoin for a long time and who have been riding the trend for a very long period of time and are looking to potentially sell. That's not to say that also it could be that those are long-term hodlers. We've got all the weekends out and it's going to be a long time before we get those kind of sellers. But I would say again to be cautious here, because if you look across the board at data science models, we're currently on the CBBI at 77 points. This could mean here, though, that we've got more room to go. If you look back through history here, it doesn't really matter what cycle you're looking at. Usually this is going to get somewhere around 95 to 100 before it actually tops out, right? So when I'm talking about the long-term trajectory here, this could continue going on for a while. In the near term, do I have a sense that it's getting a little bit manic here? Yeah, but we've crossed through the, we're getting very, very close to crossing through the previous all-time highs. And usually with that, you're going to have some continued price acceleration in the long term. Outside of that as well, if we take a look here at some of our other metrics, while again, short term, it might be a signal that we're overbought here and we might need a couple days or weeks of correction. Irrespective, if you're focused on the longer term trajectory here, we've seen that on the net unrealized profit or loss or NUPL model, this usually goes a lot higher from where it is. Right now, we're currently at 60%. Most of the time, it usually goes well above 70% through prior cycles, sometimes upwards towards 80%. So far, that showcases we've got more room to go. But the big thing I wanted to talk about here today, and it's something that I don't think a lot of people focus on, is I want to talk about distances from moving averages. And more particularly, I want to talk about the distance from the 200-week moving average. Now, this is a really interesting way, I think, to view markets because while, of course, I don't like to use just two data points as an absolute confirmation for where I believe price has to go, right? I do think that there is something quite telling here when we measure something as historic and relevant as the 200-week, and you see a pretty striking similarity between two of the more significant historic cycles, the, you know, essentially the 2015-2017 bull market, and along with that as well, the 2019-2021 bull market. The thing I want to cite here is that there's a striking similarity around a 53% decrease in the point difference from the 200-week on those previous market cycle tops. And I think that that's a very interesting dynamic here that, of course, as we expect with most cycles and with any asset growing, you know, Bitcoin, you know, won't probably go to hundreds of trillions of dollars in market cap anytime soon. You know, maybe if the dollar and fiat currencies all collapse and, you know, Bitcoin is the only thing left, then sure, maybe. But what I'm trying to get at here is being a bit more reasonable. I think Bitcoin is definitely into its maturing phase. It's getting into becoming a more recognized asset. There are the ETF inflows. Institutional capital can go towards Bitcoin rather than just going into equities as the hedging vehicle. And I think that if we use this kind of metric here, even with decaying returns, we can see, you know, even with less expansion beyond that 200-week moving average, what we can see, if we just kind of stretch it out here, is that we've still probably got a little bit of a ways to go. Like, price can continue to accelerate here. If it's going to be in line with the previous moves of the past, we probably expect it to be somewhere in this ballpark here, around 200 points from the 200-week moving average before you get that top. And that's much lower than where we were back here at 400. It's lower where we were back here around 900 points from the moving average, and also on the absolute peak back in the past, well far away from the 1900 point spread. So my main point here in saying all this is that while Bitcoin has already made a substantial move, and yes, it is approaching its prior all-time highs, there is an important point here to keep in mind, whether you are someone who's been holding positions and you're really looking to sell, or those who have been on the sidelines in cash, who are really feeling like getting a position but don't want to buy at a premium. The point I want to make here, guys, is that from a trader's perspective, according to history, it's not saying that it's guaranteed, but more likely than not, when Bitcoin approaches this close to its previous all-time highs, while there may be some sideways consolidation, there may be some kind of pullback in the meantime, it is likely your cue that over the next couple of months, Bitcoin will probably go on to set new highs, and likely significant ones from the previous ones. And I think definitely within reason is probably the $100,000 price target. I don't know if it's going to hit it exactly, if it's going to go beyond that, but I think that that's something within the cards here, considering the supply-demand imbalance and seeing how, you know, after just a week of facing some slight stagnation, 50K, we see a 20% move here blasting towards the previous highs. And I say that from experience, guys. I've traded in financial markets for over 12 years, actually coming up here almost 13 years. And essentially, I started trading in crypto in 2016. The reason I did, even though I knew about Bitcoin since 2011, and like a lot of people, I wrote it off for a long period of time. The thing is, I didn't fundamentally understand what Bitcoin was at the time. But in 2016, from a trader's perspective, I saw Bitcoin break back above its previous all-time highs, I think around $1,200 from the previous Mt. Gox highs. And for me, that was my cue that I needed to look into this. I needed to understand what Bitcoin was all about at the time. And yeah, from there, I read the Bitcoin white paper and I started to finally understand what Bitcoin really was. So I started to build positions and I rode a whole bunch of the upside here across these markets. I made wonderful percentage returns in crypto over the last couple of years. And just because while we've been skeptical here over the past couple of months of the macro environment, it doesn't mean you need to shoot yourself out of opportunities. It doesn't mean you can't admit when you got things wrong. For sure, we got 2023 wrong. We said that back in October. And since then, we've been focusing on a lot of altcoin narratives that have done even better than Bitcoin. This past week, it's been incredibly difficult to find something that's going to be up 20%. But there have been a lot of plays here in the market that have done phenomenally well, like Stacks, Render, a lot of the meme coins out there in the market. These are the kind of narratives and trends we've bet on for the past couple of months. And I think a lot of people have benefited from that. So I think, again, no matter if your focus is on altcoins or Bitcoin, the key point here is this. As we're approaching these highs here, there may be some kind of pullback. Maybe we cool down to the 21-day moving average as we've extended quite far away. But the key point is that at the end of the day, guys, no matter if you're buying at 50, 60K, I think that overall Bitcoin may have that continued room to go. And we'll be able to see clear signs within price, within the ETF inflows to determine whether or not that trend is going to change. But for now, it's remaining strong. When we take a look at Total 3 as well, this was so far the biggest expansion we've seen in Total 3 consecutively. As you can see here, we had a 37.7% move after a nice mild correction. We started to rise back up again, another 37.7%. This move here was over 42.75%. So we're not just seeing confidence return to the Bitcoin market, but we're also seeing a return to altcoins as well. And I definitely recommend you guys continue to keep an eye on what's going on between Bitcoin and Total 3, which is tracking the broader altcoin market, excluding Ethereum, because if we start to see a significant bounce here on some of these metrics, as we saw back in December, as we saw back here in June of 2023 into the summer, there could be some significant altcoin returns to be made on some of the key narratives that we've been discussing here in this channel, perhaps even some new narratives that have yet to really come up to the surface. So we're going to be keeping an eye on all those different narratives here on the channel. One of the narratives that we've talked about again here on the channel is the topic of real-world assets. And one of our partners and sponsors for today's video, and that's Arttrade, is aiming to tap exactly into that. We just did a review on Arttrade back a couple of days ago in a previous video, where we basically talked about how Arttrade is trying to bring about not only bringing NFTs into a more sustainable market by tapping into the real-world art market that's over $11 billion, but beyond that as well, taking these NFT marketplace concepts into the next level, which is essentially allowing for Arttrade to not only serve as a digital marketplace for digital claims or NFTs on pieces of art, but that there are actual physical art pieces that you can essentially claim through your NFT to be shipped directly to your home or picked up in person. And I think that that's really cool here to take something like NFTs, for example, which not only offers a lot of great benefits, having an actual digital representation and provable ownership of it on the web, on the network, but outside of that as well, being able to actually have the real physical art piece as well. So you can have your art piece, for example, in your home, and also as well in something like a metaverse reality. So I think that this is really exciting stuff. Now, if you guys haven't already checked them out, I definitely recommend you guys check out Arttrade. A couple important notable mentions is not only you can check out my review where we talked about it, but they've also got a whole range of different artists and pieces that are already live on the marketplace. So this is all right out there and ready for you to test. But outside of that as well, they recently got a listing on Nexi for their native platform utility and governance token, ATR. So I definitely recommend before you guys dive into that to understand some of the values behind the token and how it plays in the platform. But what I like is that there's a buyback built-in functionality where essentially with more trades and more sales of art on the platform, essentially should go towards benefiting the token as well by buying back some of the supply. So for me, there's a really wide range of exciting art pieces and not to mention artists as well on the platform. There's sculptors, photographers, canvas painters, a whole range of different people who are creating art. So if this is down your alley, and if you're excited about seeing these kind of more real art pieces and artists being supported by NFTs rather than the PFP or profile picture craze of Bored Ape Yacht Club and CryptoPunks and all the blanket speculation that comes and goes, I'm really excited to see the maturing of the NFT marketplace like this. This is something much more relatable to me and kind of the vision of where I see, you know, essentially, you know, cryptocurrencies and blockchains being able to actually help those artists do what they like to do. Anyways, that's it for the core part of today's video, guys. We talked a lot here today about some of the things we're watching in Bitcoin's price, when it comes to the data science models. And I think overall, I think a pretty rational take here, which is that while I don't expect Bitcoin to just go absolutely to the moon, as so many people are expecting, this is a probably traditional cycle move here for Bitcoin. At the same time, I think there's very much a chance that you could still continue to see that room here for Bitcoin to move up over the next couple of weeks and months. We'll continue to track it here on the channel. We're going to keep watching the 21-day moving average. We're going to keep watching the momentum indicators. We're going to keep watching the data science models and see how things go. And we most certainly are going to, as we have for the last two cycles, ride the altcoin wave and make some solid returns along the way. If there are any things that you guys would like me to cover here in the channel as well, I'd be happy to do that. Feel free to leave a comment down below in the comment section for what you guys would like to see. Especially on the altcoin market, I think we've got a lot of good opportunities there. But I want to let you guys know that whether or not you're focused on Bitcoin or altcoins, or if you're a long-term investor or a short-term trader, it doesn't really matter where you come from. It's important to understand that if you're in the United States or other applicable jurisdictions, it is incredibly important to take advantage of any tax avoidances systems that are legal to you. And one of those is having an IRA account or individual retirement account. And that's why I recommend you guys check out iTrust Capital. iTrust Capital is a platform that allows you to open up a crypto IRA where you can essentially deposit funds into it, meaning to your IRA contributions, and you can purchase a whole range of cryptocurrencies from your favorite altcoins to even the leaders like Bitcoin and Ethereum. And with this, you have the ability to be able to earn on your portfolio, whether you're making short-term trades or long-term investments, and anytime you trade or essentially go in and out of positions, it's tax-free. You don't have to pay any taxes on it initially. The only time you're going to pay taxes on an IRA account and the funds within it is when you want to actually cash out the IRA in retirement. And now again, I recommend you guys talk to a tax accountant, but essentially this is going to allow you to obfuscate a lot of the tax that is would originally have been paid essentially if you were trading on cryptocurrency positions actively in the market. So if you guys are looking to start preparing for retirement, you want to maximize those IRA contributions, I think it's a good thing to do if you need to plan for retirement. And I think overall, having some of your crypto allocation in an IRA is going to help set you up here where you can really start to accumulate and be able to actually materialize on a lot of the returns long-term versus having it in a normal spot account on Coinbase or even in a Bitcoin ETF. So that's it for today's video, everyone. If you guys are interested in checking out iTrust Capital or ArcTrade or any other things we mentioned here, I'll leave it down below in the description. So that's it for today's video, everyone. Hope you all have a fantastic weekend wherever you are. I'll see you guys on the next daily update on Monday, 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Take care, everyone.